Time on this verse this week. It's kind of funny that the events that went about it, and this is the message, isn't it? Yeah. Don't worry about a thing. Jude, a bondservant of Jesus Christ, a brother of James, to those who are called. I honestly could do the whole message on this particular verse. And if you we go into the book of Hebrews, which I am going to read, it breaks it down even more. But I'm going to hold off on that. And what he's saying, to those who are called and saved by God, to a particular group of people, and who are those people? It's us. Those who are saved and called by God, right? To those who will become the children, and he's going to now tell them something about yourself. So listen up, this goes to you who are called and chosen by God. Right? Beloved of the God the Father, kept for Jesus Christ. Two things that he's telling us about ourselves. Because we know we are loved and kept for God's purpose and plan, in this we what? We greatly rejoice. It should bring rejoicing into our hearts. Like, well, God is in control of everything that's going on around us. Part of God's purpose and plan requires something in our lives, and not something necessarily looks attractive to us, even though for now, a little while, if necessary, you have to suffer grief by various trials. Listen, some things we go through in this life are unnecessary suffering. Right? I'm going to give you an example of what I'm talking about there. You can't change what you did yesterday. You can't change what's happened to you in the past. And sometimes we go back there and we bring unnecessary suffering in our lives when the scriptures are very clear to let go of yesterday and to reach forward for what God has ahead. That's unnecessary suffering that we can put ourselves through. That's not God's intention for us. There's another type of unnecessary suffering that we bring into our lives, and that's disobedience to God. Because all we do is bring God's discipline into our lives. And it's unnecessary because God's made it clear in scriptures how he wants us to live and what he wants us to pursue. But when we get off track, sometimes he has to do things in our lives to bring us back in place. Now, the suffering is necessary for us to get back in place, but it's still unnecessary because we didn't have to go through it if we just remain obedient to what God's called us to do. Now, there is a type of suffering that is necessary. That's the suffering that comes into our lives for God's purposes and plans for our lives. That's clear in Scripture. That will happen. Just like the whole world is in his hands, so are our trials and suffering in his hands. These trials will show you that your faith is genuine. These are the two things. It has an effect in our life, and it's being tested as fire tests and purifies gold. Trials and suffering not only prove genuine faith, every time you come through the other side of that, you're proving your faith is genuine, because the scriptures are very clear, those who are really not saved will fall away. That's the parable of the seed, where they get choked as soon as hard times come their way. Mm-hmm. So it's an evidence that our salvation is genuine. And it also burns off the impurities in our lives, the things we're living for that God doesn't want us to live for. The results of successful trials. See how this verse just breaks down why things are hard in life? So when your faith remains strong through many trials, it will bring you much praise and glory and honor on the day when Jesus Christ is revealed to the world. And because we know trials have a purpose in this plan, we can trust, no matter what comes our way, everything's going to be all right. Now, if I'm doing my best to live faithfully for God and live for his purposes, don't worry about a thing. So Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego securely tied fell into the roaring flames, securely fell into the roaring flames of suffering. Don't worry, because every little thing is going to be all right. Look, I see four men untied walking about in the middle of the fire and what? Unharmed. And the appearance of the fourth is like the Son of God. Christ is with us through the fires. They came out stronger, steadfast in their faith, and brought glory to God. That was the result of that trial. And you don't ever hear about the devil testing those guys anymore. He knew to stand back with that crowd. Don't worry about a thing. So the king gave the order, and they brought Daniel and threw him into the lion's den. Securely he went into the lion's den for God's purposes. Don't worry, because every little thing is going to be all right. My God has sent his angel and shut the mouths of the lions. He came out with greater faith and brought God glory. Don't worry about a thing. Suddenly a furious storm came up on the lake, so the waves swept over the boat. Every storm has a purpose in his plan. Don't worry about a thing. Every little thing is going to be all right. Then Jesus got up and rebuked the winds and waves, and suddenly there was a great calm, and those of little faith gained greater faith, and God is glorified. Don't worry about a thing. He holds in his hands the depths of the earth, the mightiest mountains. God holds the whole world in his hands. Don't worry about a thing. He holds in his hands the depths of the earth, the mightiest mountains. And just like he holds the world, he holds us in his hands. Jesus said, I give them eternal life, and they will never perish, and no one will snatch them out of my hands. Just as he has the world in his hands, he's promised that we're in his hands. Don't worry about a thing, for this God is our God forever and ever. He will guide us through everything we go through. And the worst that this world can throw at us is this. He had James, the brother of John, put to death with the sword. That's the worst the world can do to you. But even that is part of his plan. He will guide us until what? Death. When your time comes, that was part of God's plan. Right? But even that, everything's going to be all right. Then the kings will say to those on his right hand, come, you are blessed of my Father. Inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. We literally go from this to glory. God's remedy for worrying. Philippians 4:6. What does it say? That's a verse. Don't worry about anything. Instead, I replace worry with something else. Pray about everything. Tell God what you need. I replace worry with prayer and trust it's all in his hands. And I can only remain thankful if I trust everything will be all right. And when I trust him, something happens. Look at the very next verse. Remember, this is a process on our part. We're trusting, but no matter what comes our way, God's in complete control. Then you'll experience God's peace, which exceeds anything we can understand. His peace will guide your hearts and minds as you live in Christ Jesus. I can have peace with the storms he brings into my life. And here's the question, do we believe it? And do we trust it, right? And Jesus asks that here. When he had gone indoors, the blind men came to him and he asked them, do you believe I am able to do this? Something we all need to ask ourselves. Do you believe it? Because I'll tell you, our actions talk way louder than our words. Mm-hmm. And it's easy to say right now, oh yeah, I believe it. But when you get hit by the storm, it's going to show if we really believe. What did this guy say? Yes, Lord, I believe. All right? He wants us to have a confident attitude. In Romans 8:28, when I use this verse a lot, and we what?
No.
Knowing is determined only by believing what God says. Not to know brings unnecessary suffering into our lives, because what are we doing? We start to worry. That's not God's will, because he already said, don't be anxious about anything. Don't worry about anything. In order to know, we would have to believe some things about God. Numbers 23:19, God is not a man, he does not lie. We would have to trust his word, that he will live up to his word. In order to know, he is not a human, so he does not change his mind. We would have to believe God does not go back on his word. In order to know, has he ever spoken and failed to act? We would have to trust his track record is perfect. In order to know, you have searched me, O Lord, you know me. O Lord, you have examined my heart. You know what about me? Everything about me. You wonder why David had such confidence, huh? Right? We would have to believe he knows everything about us, everything we are going through. In order to know, I am with you always, even to the end of the world, amen, we would have to trust he is with us through everything. He is in the fire. He is in the lion's den. He is in the storms. He's with us. All part of his plan. I see four men in the fire. In order to know, for I am sure that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will ever be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. We have to believe that no matter what comes our way, we're in his hands and he loves us. And he's in full control. In order to know, you keep track of all of my sorrows. You have collected all my tears in your Bible. You have recorded each one in your book. We would have to trust that what we go through means something to him. In order to know, casting all your anxieties on him because he cares for you. That's why you do it, you know. We would have to believe that he cares not only about us, but also the things that are causing us to worry. In order to know, and if we know that he hears us in whatever we ask, we would have to trust he hears us when we pray. But your prayers aren't bouncing off the ceiling. I say that to him sometimes, by the way. Well, my point is, it feels that way sometimes, right? But no. Then I just remind myself, God says, no, I hear you when you pray. Right? In order to know, fear not, I am with you. Be not dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you. I what? Will help you. Right? I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. We would have to believe when we pray he will help us. We would have to believe. God does not lie. God does not change his mind. When God says something, he takes action to do it. We can trust his promises. He knows us personally. He loves us. He is with us. He cares about the things causing us pain. He hears us when we pray, and he will help us. If you're going to know, you have to believe these things. All right? If we know these things, and we know, we can come to a conclusion that in all things, everything in this life, no matter what comes our way, we can have confidence that God is involved in every aspect of our lives, good or bad. When we believe and trust and we know, we can know that every little thing, that in all things God works for the good, is going to be all right, because it's all part of his plan in our lives to work together for good, for his cause and his glory. And only if we know, listen, what is that finally you want? See, that's action on our part. You're not strong. You have to be strong. And the only way you can be strong in the strength of his might, and we can be strong in our faith. David said to the Philistine, you come against me with sword and spear and javelin, but I come against you in the name of the Lord Almighty. We have to believe that God can do what looks impossible to us. Now, there is a disclaimer in this, right? God's promises do not apply to everyone. There are criteria for knowing everything is going to be all right, right? Psalm 7:11 says God is angry with the wicked every day. God's promises are only to God's people. The devil's people cannot know everything is going to be all right, but because of your stubbornness and unrepentant heart, you are storing up wrath for yourself on the day of wrath and revelation, the righteous judgment of God. They can't have a peace in that, because nothing's going to turn out right for an unsaved person. In the end, is hell forever. Disclaimer, this is not a prosperity gospel. These Christians cannot know. That is why many are weak, sick, and some of you have even died. I can't have confidence everything is going to be all right when I am living in disobedience to God. But then you have to say, oof. The criteria is to those who are called, who have been called according to his purpose, to those who are living according to his purpose. Therefore, my dear brothers and sisters, stand firm. Let nothing move you. Always give yourselves fully to the work of the Lord, because you know that your labor in the Lord is not in vain. And only if we are living according to his will can we know. Do not conform to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you'll be able to test and approve what God's will is, good and pleasing and perfect will. And that's written to Christians. Then, see the then? When I'm start living for God, when it becomes real, I'm not just listening to his word anymore, I'm applying it to my life. I'm going to live for God now. I made a choice, and I'm going to be obedient to what the Bible says, and I'm going to start following him. All right? If I'm saved, obedient, and living for his purposes, we wait him out confidently, wait patiently for the Lord, and while waiting, we remain resolute and trust what we know, be strong. Action on our part. We do not let danger, pain, or suffering deter us. And courageous. That's why he adds that in there. Even extended lengths of times, wait patiently for the Lord. That's why he says it twice. God sometimes is going to make you wait extended periods of time before he shows up in that circumstance. And just like Job, we remain faithful. We give great honor to those who endure under suffering. We give great honor to those who endure under suffering. Think about that verse. For instance, you know about Job, and if you haven't read it, read it. a man of great, what? Endurance. You can see how the Lord was kind to him at the end. For the Lord is full of tenderness and mercy. We wait him out and see what he does. And in the meantime, we do what? We remain faithful. All right? And while we're waiting, finally, brothers and sisters, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, if there's anything excellent or praiseworthy, think about those things. Don't think about your circumstances. Don't think about how you want to beat that person up who did the wrong thing to you. I have a hard time with that. Oh, sorry, God, sorry. And now, dear brothers and sisters, one final thing. Fix your thoughts on what is true, honorable, and right, and pure, and lovely, and admirable. Think about things that are excellent and worthy of praise. We think and focus on the positive things God has commanded. And we fix our eyes and lives on Christ. Let us fix our eyes on Jesus, the author and perfecter. He's perfecting our faith through difficult circumstances. We follow his example of how he handled suffering. Our eyes are on Christ and his example of how he dealt with it. And we focus on doing everything for the Lord's glory, commit everything you do to the Lord, put our hope and confidence in him, trust him, and wait for his promises, and he will help you. See how this steps? We keep focused on Jesus' priorities, seek the kingdom of God above all else. Be obedient to what he says and live righteously and trust that every little thing is going to be right and he will give you everything you need.
Amen.
Whatever is right, whatever is lovely. Be anxious for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Finally, brethren, whatever things are true, whatever things are noble, whatever things are just, whatever things are pure, whatever things are lovely, whatever things are of good report, if there is any virtue and if there is anything praiseworthy, meditate on these things. The things which you learned and received and heard and saw in me, these do, and the God of peace will be with you.
Thank you.
guys started getting it towards the end, right? Recipe for the peace of God, finally, brothers and sisters, whatever's true, whatever's honorable, whatever's right, whatever's pure, whatever's lovely, whatever's commendable, if there's anything excellent and praiseworthy, worthy of praise, think about these things, focus on God, and think and act accordingly. Recipe for fear and anxiety and depression, I just reversed, put the antonyms in place of these words. Finally, brothers and sisters, whatever's false, whatever is dishonorable, whatever is wrong, whatever is impure, whatever is vile, whatever is despicable, if there's any mediocrity, and if there's anything unworthy of praise, think about those things. Your choice, my choice, right? Focus on the world and think and act accordingly. Facing adversity requires a positive attitude. Don't copy the behavior and customs of this world, but let God transform you into a new person by changing the way you are thinking. Right? A positive attitude requires a right type of thinking, and it's according to God's word. If the courage of conviction, integrity, credibility, and uncompromising devotion to virtue are admirable qualities for people in the world, how much more essential are they for Christians? The very name of Christianity identifies believers with Jesus Christ, who is the perfect model of uncompromising, courageous integrity, whoever lived, no matter what he went through. Right? The New Testament repeatedly commands believers to follow Christ by standing firm in submission to God, following his example. So announcements, I put down these Bible studies. So we're going to have a 7 to 8 Bible study, and then Sunday morning we're going to have a Bible study 9 to 9:50. That's Jamil and Chris. And so Eric, Jamil, and Chris, raise your hands. Right? So two Bible studies. You have no excuse. Show up for one, right? It's very important you learn God's word. So September, I'm thinking, what you guys said, September for those guys, and I think Eric starts in October, it's up to him.
September.
Okay, I'm starting in October, though, just so you know. And then Donnie's at Berkshire Place, North Providence, third floor. I went there yesterday, he's doing much better, and he's walking up and down the halls now, and he says he goes forward and then backwards a little bit, but he seemed positive. That's good, and it's important that he remains positive. So I understand Providence is a bit of a trip, but if you're up there, pay him a visit. And then Mary's still at the Scalp Show, and she's doing better too. Susan informed me she's going up and downstairs too. So that's fantastic. That's where they're holding her there so that she's able to walk before she leaves. And so, and she's locally, you can swing by there. And Janet, keep her in prayer. She's struggling with medications, and God would balance those things for her. And there's other people. Like I said, pick somebody in the church. I mean, everybody's going through something, right? Pick somebody. And so we're talking about attitude and thinking when facing adversity. I want to do the enemy next week and schemes of the enemy. Just one of those reminder messages. We need to realize there is an enemy in this world called Satan, all right? And one of those messages I'm going to bring once a year. And then the following week I want to do his schemes, what's he actually doing in this world. But we can see a little bit of what he's doing in this world. So anyways, we're going to pray before we start. And I am going to be teaching on the book of Hebrews starting in September also. So you got some really good teaching coming in. Hebrews is a great book.
Yes.
Let me tell you something. This information in the book of Hebrews, that there's no other parts of the scriptures. Your position in Christ, how God's discipline is used in our lives, which applies a lot to this message, but I didn't use it. It breaks down way more there than it does in any other part of the scripture. And so don't miss, you need it. We need it, right? And so let's pray. Heavenly Father, God, we thank you for your word, and we thank you, God, that it could change the way we think. And I pray it would have that effect in all our lives, Lord. We'd start thinking what you say instead of what the world and circumstances say. We focus on Christ and not this world. And I pray it would go forth like fire in our hearts, Lord, and it would produce action, God, not just sit there. And I pray for Donnie. I pray for complete recuperation of his body. I pray for Mary, Lord, for her strengthening, that she will be able to walk and come out of that place. For Janet with her medications, Lord. For anyone who is suffering physically, Lord, I think of different people, Nick's shoulder. Brett's doing better. I can pray for him. And anybody suffering physically, those suffering emotionally, Lord, those who might be discouraged, we're not saying anything. I pray you bring your peace, your joy, your encouragement into their lives, Lord. And you just bless your house and people, God, and knit us together in unity, that we would love and serve you together as one and have a great effect, God, in South County, Rhode Island, and branch out from there for Christ. And it's in his name, Lord, we pray. Amen.
Amen.
So remember, how we think affects how we what live. For as a man or woman thinks in their heart, so are they. That's a promise from God. How you think is how you will live your life. All right? Believe and trust lives a certain way. Fear and worry lives a certain way. All right? Paul, who dealt with more adversity than any other in the scriptures, I can't say in life, and Job dealt with a lot of this. Maybe some people who dealt with even more, but he uses himself here. Paul said, as an example, whatever you have learned or received or heard from me or seen in me, put into what? Practice. These things are written for our examples so that we can live our lives after them, and the God of peace will be with you. It's a promise, right? Or keep putting into practice all you learned and received from me and everything you heard from me and saw me doing, then the God of peace will be with you. He used himself as an example of the thinking necessary for the right attitude when facing adversity, and there's no better guy who can give this type of advice. I always said, you want advice on something, talk to somebody who's been through it. Don't talk to somebody who has no clue, right? Yeah, I'm blown away. I mean, if you want advice on marriage, don't talk to a priest who's never been married. You get my point, right? I mean, pick somebody who's been involved, who's struggled over the years, knows the highs and lows, and anything, any aspect of it. Be wise on who you pick for counsel in your life. It'll change the way you think. Be careful with that. That's very dangerous ground. You make sure they have a God perspective. He gave us the right tools to face adversity. Do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation, by prayer and petition, he gave us the right attitude with thanksgiving, and he gave us the right action. Present your request to God. This verse is more about attitude we have when facing adversity rather than the theology of prayer. That's the attitude. I'm going to pray about it. I'm going to trust God in it. I'm going to put it in his hands. I'm going to continue to live for him, no matter what comes my way. All right. The command of this text is for believers to cry out to God when they have need or problem with this type of attitude, instead of doubting, questioning, or blaming God. Here's the wrong action when hard times come your way. In the desert, the whole community, what? Grumbled and complained against Moses and Aaron. Who were they really grumbling and complaining against?
God.
When if you stop moaning and groaning about your life, you are moaning and groaning to God. And that's including me. I put you through sometimes. That's me too. Because I do a lot of moaning and groaning sometimes. And I remind myself, I don't want to be like those guys in the desert, right? All right? Well, only when we trust God is using circumstances to change us, and I am certain that God, who began a good work within you, will continue his work until it is finally finished on the day when Christ returns. What are you saying? As long as you're here on this earth, God is working on you. And guess what he uses most of the time when he's working on you? Hard times. That's why he says even Christ learned obedience through hard times, through suffering, right? Can we have confidence in difficult times if we trust him that it's part of his plan for our lives? That's the only way you're going to have confidence, right? Only when I trust circumstance transforms me, right? But we all, with unveiled faces looking as a mirror at glory of the Lord, are being transformed into the same image from glory to glory, just as from the Lord the Spirit can I have confidence. That's it. Right? Only when I trust suffering makes me stronger in my faith in the God of all grace, who called you to his eternal glory in Christ after you have, what? Suffered a little while. A little while can be a long while to us. But in the light of eternity, it's always a little while, right? Will himself what? Restore you and make you strong, firm, and steadfast. Those are promises from God. If you endure and trust him. Only when I trust God will give me what I can handle, right? No temptation is overtaking you except something common to mankind, and God is faithful. So he will not allow you to be tempted beyond what you are able. What are you saying now? I won't put too much on your plate. What you are facing right now, I've already given you the strength to get through it. You trust me. Are you going to put your confidence in me that you're able to face whatever comes your way in this life, no matter how painful it is, no matter what's going on in the world around us? We must face adversity with truth of God's word. Finally, brothers and sisters, whatever is true. This is our thinking now. We're going through the thinking process, right? We're not trusting, and now how do we think when all these things are happening? Whatever is true, according to fact or reality. Paul gives us some insight as to what is true. Let God be true in every human being in your life. What does that say? Every time something in your mind or somebody outside says something that's opposite of God's word, we let God be true and everybody else be a what?
Liar.
When you get those negative thoughts in your mind, that's not God. Mm-hmm. Right? We have an enemy. And believe me, he's whispering in your ear all the time.
That's right.
Right? We face adversity with God's truth because there is no truth outside of God's word. We must remain positive in our thinking in adversity. Finally, brothers and sisters, whatever is honorable, honorable, performed or accompanied with integrity, high regard and respect. We face adversity with God's calls honorable. Right now, in a great house, there are not only vessels of gold and silver, but also of wood and clay, and some for honorable use and some for dishonorable. That's talking about Christians right there. That you can be a vessel of honor for God, or you can actually dishonor God with your life. That's a choice we make. All right, Paul gives us some insight on this. If you keep yourself pure, you will be a special utensil for honorable use. Your life will be clean, and you'll be ready for the Master to use you for every good work. All right, we focus on being honorable vessels no matter what comes our way. We face adversity with what is right. Finally, brothers and sisters, whatever is right, morally good, justified, or acceptable. Solomon gives us some wisdom concerning what is right. A person may think in their own ways they are right, but the Lord, what? Weighs the heart. Now, you may think you're right with God. And I like that church in the book of Revelation. He says, you think you're rich, but you're poor, miserable in my sight. Right, make sure our lives are matching up with Scripture says is what? Right. That's how you know you're right. The Lord is more pleased when we do what is right and just than when we offer him sacrifices. We remain faithful doing what God's word says is right. We face adversity with what is pure. Finally, brothers and sisters, whatever is pure, pure, not mixed or adulterated. David gives some insight on pure. And the Lord's promises are pure, like silver refined in a furnace, purified seven times over. We face adversity believing God's promises are not mixed or adulterated. Like we talked about earlier, he doesn't change his mind. When he says it, he'll do it. I think a lot of times we give up before he comes through. We face adversity with what is lovely. Finally, brothers and sisters, whatever is lovely, whatever is sweet, gracious, generous, or patient. Paul gives us some insight to this type of thinking. Be kindly affectionate to one another with brotherly love. That's talking to each other here. In honor, giving preference to one another. That means prefer Christians over unsaved people. Not lagging in diligence, fervent in spirit, serving the Lord. Rejoicing in hope, patient in tribulation, continuing steadfast in prayer. Distributing to the needs of the saints, given to hospitality. Bless those who persecute you. Bless and do not curse. That's a tough one, huh? That's a real tough one. Me and Rich deal with that every week. There's always some angry person. And I go, okay, we got to bless them. These are things we're supposed to be thinking about and doing while we're going. This is while you're going through difficult circumstances. Rejoice with those who rejoice and weep with those who weep. You see how everything's focused on other people and not my circumstances? Be of the same mind one toward another. Do not be proud, but be willing to associate with people of low positions. Think about that. Do not be conceited. Repay no one evil for evil. Have a regard for good things in the sight of all men. And if it's possible, as much as depends on you, live peaceably with all people. Boy, that's some good advice, huh? We must face adversity with a lovely attitude and action. Circumstances don't change the way we live. We always keep God's priorities our focus. And that's fixing our eyes on Christ. You never see Christ lash out at people, except the people who are teaching his word wrong, right? You don't see him punching people when they punch them. You don't see him letting people. I understand he could have went, and they're done. Good thing I'm not God. Let's straighten out the world real quick. We face adversity with what is commendable. Finally, brothers and sisters, whatever is commendable, worthy of high praise. Paul gives us some insight as well as what is commendable. Whatever you do, work it with all your heart as working for the Lord, not for human masses. Ask yourself, do you live that verse? Do you go, everything that I do, God, I want to live today for you? Do you get up in the morning and say that? Do you get up in the morning and say, what can I do for you this morning? Is there somebody I can talk to about Christ today, God? Is there something I can do to help encourage a Christian today? Is there something I can do positive in your work to further your kingdom today? Are we really living for the Lord? That's the question we all have to ask, right? Are we living commendable lives? Is God going to one day say to you, well done, good and faithful servant, you lived for me while you were down there? We must face adversity commendably without complaining, honoring the Lord. And Paul sums up the way we should be thinking. Finally, brothers and sisters, if there's any excellence and if in anything worthy of praise, well, think about those things. If there's anything of excellence in the sight of God, if there's anything that brings God's praise, what does the Bible command us to do? So whatever you eat or drink, whatever you do, do it all for the glory of God. And I've always said, when you're eating and drinking, what's the one way you can bring glory to God? Yeah. Do you pray before you eat? Do you publicly, when you're out in public, do you stop and go, thank the Lord for this meal? Everything you do. Everything, think about that. Everything, he's saying, do it. Everything you do, find a way to use it for me. Mm-hmm. You have a business of your own, you should be trying to find a way to glorify God. Mm-hmm. I've always said if I was a car dealer, I'd throw a track in the glove compartment. I pass out tracks in the bags. Anything, just find a way, somehow, some way, to use it for God's glory. Because if you're not, you're just wasting, mm-hmm. you're wasting your life. And one day, we're all going to stand before him. We face adversity, trusting and bringing God's praise, right? And the key to godly living is godly thinking. Above all else, guard your heart, for everything you do flows from it. When all is said and done, spiritual stability comes down to living a disciplined life to God's standards. People in whom the Word of God richly dwells and lives obediently will stand firm when the winds of difficulty, temptation, and compromises blow around them. The trouble with a man of little faith is that he does not think. He allows circumstances to bludgeon him. And that is the real difficulty in life. Life comes at us with a club in its hand and strikes us on the head, and we become incapable of thought, helpless, and defeated. And the way to avoid that, according to the Lord, is to think. The Bible is full of logic. We must not sit in a lounge chair or expect marvelous things to happen. That is not Christian faith. Christian faith is essentially thinking. Look at the birds and think about them. Look at the grass and the lilies of the field and consider and draw your deductions or conclusions. We do not sit down and ask, what is going to happen to me? What can I do? This is the absence of thought. It is the surrender. It is defeat. Our Lord is urging us to think and think in a Christian manner. That is the very essence of faith. Strong faith is a man or woman insisting upon thinking when everything seems determined to bludgeon and knocking them down to an intellectual sense about what the Bible says about to do concerning the topic. Instead of controlling their thoughts, the Bible controls their thoughts. The essence of worry is the absence of God's thoughts. And we know, which can only be accomplished if I believe God's word. He did not do many miracles there because they what? Did not believe. You can actually limit what God does in your life simply because you don't believe it, or I don't believe it. All right? The battlefield will always be our minds. I can't be strong if I don't believe it. And finally, be strong in the Lord and the strength of his might. Action on our part. Remember that, right? When I went to visit Donnie yesterday, I said, Douglas, I want you to understand something. God put you here. And you have something to do, and that has something to do with this plan in your life. And you're going to come out, if you're steadfast, strong, secure, with God's help, if you remain faithful. So before I left, I said, who put you here, Donnie? He went, God put me here. I said, what does he want you to do? He says, tell somebody about Christ. We're always where we are for a reason. And we have to trust that, or we're going to go crazy in this world.
Song I wrote. might want to sing it note for note, don't worry. Be happy. In every life we have some trouble. When you worry, you make it double. Don't worry. Be happy. Don't worry. Be happy now. To lay your head, somebody came and took your bed. Don't worry, be happy. The landlord say your rent is late, he may have to litigate. Don't worry, be happy.
Look at me, I'm happy.
No cash, ain't got no style, ain't got no gal to make you smile, but don't worry, be happy. Cause when you worry, your face will frown, and that will bring everybody down. So don't worry, be happy. Don't worry, be happy now. Don't worry, be happy. Don't worry, be happy.
You got the point, right? Do you know? And I know. Do you know? If I meet the Creator, love God, living for His purpose, thinking about right things, instead of worrying, I replace with prayer and thankfulness, don't worry about a thing, and we can have confidence knowing that God works everything for what?
Yeah, good.
That's what the Bible says. Do you believe that God keeps His word? Do you think He's a liar?
Yeah.
And when we respond the other way, what are we really saying? Yeah. So just remind us. That's why it says remind. Change the way you think. Remind ourselves. Doesn't mean we're not going to feel that way sometimes, but we remind ourselves and get us off that track, right? I love that kid. Did he look like he had a worry in the world? That's his house in the back. That's what God's saying. I'm in control. That fire is not going to touch you unless I want it to, and if it does, I'll be with you in it. He's with us in everything. Everything going on in this world is in His what? Yes. Stop worrying. Let Him do His thing. Whatever the way the world goes, it goes. We, in the meantime, what do? We faithfully serve the Lord. See? Yeah, see, that's our example of faithfulness, right? That's what we do to the Lord, right? Just faithfully go over. All right, let's pray. Heavenly Father, God, we thank You for Your word, and we thank You, God. It does bring us peace if we, God, be strong, if we'll trust You. And I pray, God, that Your word would go forth in our hearts and we would learn that whatever comes our way, God, You're using it for our good. Some way, somehow, even though we don't understand it, may never understand it here, God, somehow, in some way, we need to trust, Lord, that You only put in our lives what we can handle. You've already given us the strength, Lord. And if we're faithful, You will help. Help us to look at Job, God, and see the outcome in his life. And be willing to face, God, life without worry. In Christ's name, amen.